Hey, what's going on, everybody? This is Mike at HiFiInsider.com. So we are coming close to the end of 2017, and I thought I'd share with you what I am using on my desk. This is my work desk. I work from home, and some of the things that I've chosen for my personal use, and some of the things that I found to be really interesting. Some are audio related, and some are tech related. So hope you guys like this video, and if you do, let me know in the comments, and maybe we'll do more of these non-audio specific videos. So the first thing is the 27-inch iMac behind me. It is a 2017 model. I took a long time in thinking about which one to get and if I should get one that's built to order with all the upgrades and stuff. And after probably a month worth of detail analyzing the specs and the researching some of the features that it has, I ended up with a stock model. But it's the flagship stock build. I bought it from Apple Store directly, and it came with a pair of Beats headphones because it was a student discount. This is the 3.8 gigahertz i5 processor with the Radeon Pro 580. 8 gigabytes of video RAM, which is plenty. I went ahead with the Fusion Drive instead of the upgrade to an SSD because the Fusion Drive actually has 128 gigabytes of super fast SSD for the operating system and whatever apps that you're currently running. And then anything that you're not actively using, it offloads to a 2 terabyte spinning hard drive, which I think it makes a lot of sense because video files or audio music files that I'm using to listen to music with, they're stored files. They're not constantly accessing these. I'm not constantly accessing these files. So I don't really need the super fast SSD that I'm paying a premium for outside of the operating system and launching apps, which the Fusion Drive does very good. The 8 gigabytes of video RAM is plenty of horsepower for iMovie, which I use to edit these videos. I'm not on Final Cut Pro yet, and watching 4K videos, even 5K videos, plenty of horsepower. 8 gigabytes is really plenty of RAM for the operating system. And Apple wanted a lot of money to upgrade to 16 gigabytes of RAM. So what I did was I went on Mac Rumors forums, and I asked people if they want to sell me their 8 gigabytes of stock RAM that they're upgrading to 16 or 32 or 64, because this machine can go up to 64 gigabytes. And sure enough, people were ripping off their RAM right out of a brand new iMac and selling it for dirt cheap. So I think I paid like $50 for another 8 gigabytes of RAM. So I wanted them to be exactly the same as what came with my iMac, which is a Micron, made in China. It was 2 sticks of 4 gigabytes. So I added another 2 sticks of 4 gigabytes to make it 16 gigabyte of RAM for only $50. And they were exactly the same as what Apple shipped me in this iMac. So that was a real money saver. I also didn't upgrade the processor. I found that the i5 3.8 gigahertz is plenty of horsepower for what I'm using. Also, because of the thermal on the iMac, there's only one fan, and if I upgrade to the i7, it will actually run hotter, so it will actually throttle down sooner than if I was with an i5. So that means I'm paying a premium for an i7 and really not getting the performance of it because the computer's throttling it because of the thermal sealing of the basically the chassis, the design of this machine. So at the end of the day, I picked it up from an Apple Store, $2,000, and I'm very happy with it. I've been using it since August now, no hiccups. I was a little bit worried about the Fusion Drive, but right now, not a single concern with the Fusion Drive. And I think it actually makes a lot of sense to go with the Fusion Drive. The 5K display is gorgeous. Watching 4K videos on YouTube is spectacular. Now, what's interesting is that 4K movies, from iTunes that you can buy or stream now can only be streamed to an Apple TV 4K. It's not playable in 4K on an iMac, which is rather silly to me. I wrote to Tim Cook about that, no response of course, and I hope that eventually they will bring that to the iMac so you can actually watch it in 4K, because this is a beautiful display and not being able to watch movies in 4K on it seems a little silly. Another thing I did with the iMac is adding a front-loading USB port, basically a hub in the front of it, which is more convenient. It's not a high-power hub, but it does the job. It syncs your devices. It charges my iPhone. It's just a lot more convenient than spinning the iMac around and trying to get that cable around back. It's also a lot cleaner looking. Another thing that I did was I actually attached a SuperDrive, Apple SuperDrive, to the base of the iMac. I basically used little strip of double-sided tape and put it stuck it on here so it doesn't slide around. This allows me to have a CD, a DVD drive with the iMac. Now, don't use too much double-sided tape because you won't be able to get it off. I just use two strips of very, very tiny strips just to hold it in. One thing that really annoyed me with the iMac was that the iMac screen is nice and heavy, but the base kind of slides around when you push it. So sometimes when you nudge it, it kind of gets out of position. And I'm kind of a little bit OCD about my iMac being straight. So what I did was I added a sort of like a rubberized pad to the bottom of the iMac stand, that way it doesn't, when you push it, it doesn't move around. Yeah. So I can easily tilt it up and down without moving it side to side. It's really nice, that way you don't have to keep centering your iMac. I wish Apple would have done that on the iMac itself. If you're an AirPod user like I am and you want a nice looking stand for it, there are a few on Amazon, but I found them to be rather intrusive, not the minimalist design that I like. What I found was the Apple's own iPhone dock, the white one, works really well with the AirPods. And I can plug it into the front of the iMac and I simply dock my AirPods in there. And it's really nice looking. It's authentic Apple product, so really cool. Just a tip there. If you have a MacBook like I do, this is the 2017 MacBook Pro. This is the base model, not the Touch Bar model. And what I did was I upgraded the RAM, that's it. I didn't do anything else. I didn't need the Touch Bar. I think it's silly. I wanted a dock that actually matches the color of the MacBook, silver. Surprisingly, silver is not all the same. This one I found matched really well with the MacBook. And I love the way it looks. I love the build quality of it. It's all aluminum and it doesn't slide around the desk. And you simply dock your MacBook on there, and you can either, you know, use it to charge, basically just less desk space that it takes up, or if you use it with an external monitor, it's a very nice dock for it, and not a lot of money, so really cool. Now to the audio stuff. Another product that I've been looking for, and it was rather difficult to find, was an iPad stand that isn't intrusive and works well and not overly expensive. What I found was from 10-1 Design is the Magnus Air iPad stand. They make it for iPad Air and also the original iPad 3, 4, check out the website, but several versions of the iPad, nothing on the Pro yet, but the Air, which is what I have, works really well. Let me show you. Now, I use my iPad to stream Tidal. It's really convenient, very low profile, very low overhead. The battery lasts a long time. And the beautiful thing about the stand, I'm going to plug this first. It's how minimal the design is. You could barely see it. And here's around the back. So it's really nice. And the cool thing about the stand is that it is magnetic. You hear that? So it doesn't tip over if you knock it. And also it doesn't wobble when you tap the screen. So really nice design. I can't believe that not a lot of people know about this product. And I think that it is absolutely brilliant. And it works really well for me and for anyone I think uses an iPad as a music station. The iPad Air, which rather inexpensive now because it's such an old model, and you can get the Air or Air 2 and get the stand, and you have a really nice streaming music service, basically a music server for your audio system. Another thing that I like about the stand is how compact it is. You can literally stick this into your pocket when you're traveling, and you have a very nice and simple stand for your iPad while you're on an airplane and want to watch a movie or something. It's got a rubberized material so it doesn't scratch the surface of your iPad, and it's very lightweight and it's very effective. I love this stand. I think that this is brilliant. Originally, when I first opened the box, I felt that it feels a little bit cheap, but then the more I used it, the more I realized that the lightweight of this stand is really by design, because when you have this in your pocket, you don't want something that's very heavy and that will weigh you down when you're traveling with the stand. This is a phenomenal product, and I think that you guys should check it out. Now, what I'm using with the iPad and with my iMac is the Sony Signature Series DAC amplifier. It works really well because it's got two USB inputs, one on the side, which is what I use for the iPad when I use listen to Tidal, and one around back, which is connected directly to the iMac via the USB ports. Now, the iMac has Thunderbolt 3 as well, so a lot of connectivity, and I think this is the best desktop computer on the market. The Sony DAC amp, it's a superior DAC. A lot of DACs on the market just doesn't sound as good as this guy. For $2,300, it's a DAC and a headphone amplifier. You can use your iOS device. Of course, you'll need the Apple's Lightning to USB adapter, and then just a standard micro USB cable. And you connect it to your Tidal or whatever music service you have, or even music that's already stored on your iPad or your iPhone, and the Sony DAC will process it. And I have it out to my Lehman Audio headphone amplifier, which adds more oomph to the sound. So when I'm using over-the-ear headphones that need a little bit more oomph, I use the Lehman Audio. When I'm using in-ear headphones, I'm using the Sony, because the Sony works really, really well with in-ear headphones, like the Westone W80, which is one of my favorites, and also the Odyssey LCD i4. Those two IEMs are the best on the market, hands down. I don't know if anyone's going to be able to beat them in the near future, but right now, if you want the best IEMs, those two are the best. You can also use Sony Walkman, of course. And when you use the Walkman, it comes with the amp comes with a cable for you to connect the Walkman's digital port to the amplifier, so that you can use the Walkman as a source. Another thing that you guys have seen in many of my videos is this Sony server. This is Sony's top of the line music server, and it sounds spectacular. It sounds better than some of the DACs on the market that cost $6,000-$7,000. The server costs $2,000, which is less expensive than the amplifier itself. It comes internally with 1 terabyte of spinning hard drive, it's not SSD, because there's really no need for SSD when you're storing music. So I upgraded to a 2 terabyte. I have a tutorial on my website, Hi-Fi Insider, on how to upgrade the hard drive. And this guy is outstanding. Very easy to control on a mobile app or on the screen itself. And the sound is just amazing. I have it hooked up via the analog RCA output to the Sony amp, and then out to the Lehman amp. One of the best music servers that I've tried, and for $2,000, it's a phenomenal bargain. The headphone stand that I'm using, it is actually the official Sony MDR Z1R headphone stand made in Japan. It's from Deaf Sound Japan. It's only available in Japan. My friend went to Tokyo this year. He bought two of these for me. And it's a beautiful little headphone stand, very minimal design, all aluminum. You just assemble it together yourself, and it's got some leather material on the top here and on the base here. And this is the branding. I wish it comes in silver, because I hope everything here is, you know, silver, but black looks fine on my setup as well. And I really like it. It's kind of pricey. It was $100 for the stand, 100 US, but you know, I love how minimal the design is and how beautiful the construction is. So wiring this whole setup here, I have all Nordos cables, and which I think they are one of the best on the market. Another cable company that I like is Kimber Cables. They make really good audio cables as well. So between those two, I used to use Monster Cable back in the early 90s. They were actually pretty decent cables. Nothing really to say bad about them, in my opinion. They are a little bit pricey. Another company that I like is AudioQuest. You know, cables is one of the things that I think is important, and I like good quality cables because they can be used with any audio equipment, so it's not tied down to a specific brand or model of audio equipment. So once you buy them, they'll last forever, and I really don't have any issues with them. Back in the day, I also liked MIT as well, but today I think Nordos and Kimber are a little bit better. So all this stuff are connected to the Nordos power strip, and then to a Nordos conditioner, and then to a Monster power stabilizer. Now my home here don't really have a power issue, but if yours fluctuates a lot, typically you want to stay around 119 volt, 121. But if yours fall below 117 or exceeds 121, then you should consider looking into a voltage stabilizer system. I've had the Power Center for many years now, and I don't think Monster makes it anymore, but PS Audio makes a very good Power Center, but they're pretty pricey. A lot of you are like me, don't really listen to classical music, but I think that it is important to have some sort of reference level music. One of the classical albums that I like is actually considered classical humor, because it's really not, you know, kind of official classical music, but it is very well produced, very well recorded. The label is from Telarc, which is a very reputable recording label. It's the PDQ Bach 1712 Overture. It's very entertaining to listen to. Some commentaries between songs, so it's really cool. It's classical music, well recorded, and it's fun to listen to, and I highly recommend you guys to check that out. So lastly is a shameless plug. But I think that I want to share it with you guys because I haven't found such a product that's as effective and as elegant as what I have here. It's the leather sleeve for MacBook and MacBook Pro 2016-2017 model. I actually had this sleeve custom made by Copper River in California, Copper River Leather Bag Company. Very high quality, genuine leather, very soft, and made in the USA here in California. So what's so special about this sleeve is that it's lined with suede on the inside. This is how I wanted them to make it. And it's nice and thick. I'm not sure if you can see the thickness of the leather. So when your MacBook or MacBook Pro is inside, it protects it very nicely. And it's, I like using the MacBook naked because I can really appreciate the industrial design of the product. But I certainly want to protect it when I'm traveling or when I'm storing it. So this version is the MacBook Pro version. And basically you just slide it in and it fits tightly. It's got enough spacing here to, and it's firm enough on the bottom. So if this is in your backpack and it lands on the floor, it doesn't damage your MacBook, even on the corners as well. So really nice. So I have a few of these on hand if anyone's interested. It sells for $140 for the Pro version. And then I also have a version for the MacBook, which is you can go 2015, 2016, 2017 MacBook fits in the sleeve. Or an iPad, 12-inch iPad, also fits in the sleeve. Same deal, same nicely padded, very durable, and as the sleeve age, it actually adds character to the product, and I really like it. I've had this one for over a year now. I've actually made these for almost a year now, and I never really talked about it. If you guys are interested, I also have the 12-inch and the 13-inch MacBook Pro sleeves available. The 12-inch it sells for $125. Okay everyone, that's it. Now, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. It's a little long, but I hope it covered some of the things that I found interesting, and I hope you guys found it interesting. And let me know in the comments what you think about this video. I'll see you guys again in the next one. Bye-bye.